So the Lord said to us this year, He said that for those of us that would operate in and those of us that would hold things, notice the word hold, hold things in the realm of the Spirit, that His glory would show up, that His glory would come, that His glory would manifest. Well, what's the glory of God? Well, the glory of God is pretty much God Himself. It's the substance of heaven. It's everything that's God. And so the glory of God showing up means that whatever's necessary, whatever's needful for that moment, that God's going to intervene, that God's going to show up, that God's going to fix things, God's going to rearrange things, God's going to work things out, He's going to straighten things out, He's going to make things happen. Spiritual things are going to happen in our favor. Amen? God said, He said to us that when the glory shows up, that the desired results will come. Amen? And so I know that the church a lot of times does a lot of praying about the glory of God. And so what I have found, you know, over some time here is that there are things that are necessary. There are things, spiritual things. There are spiritual atmospheres. There are spiritual attitudes that make a way for the glory of God to come. And so if we're going to participate like we want to with the glory of God, with the kingdom of God, then we're going to have to be able to identify some of these things and know them so that we can make way for the glory of God in our lives. And so when the Lord said that to me about operating in and holding things in the realm of the Spirit, well, you know, I thought, okay, now what does He mean by that? You know, God, what do You mean by that? And He prompted me in Romans 14:17. So this is a foundational scripture. He prompted me to that scripture. It says, "For the kingdom of God is not in eating and drinking, but is righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit." Yes. Hallelujah. So we could say that the kingdom of God is in the Spirit. We could say that the kingdom of God is righteousness, peace, and joy. We could say that the atmosphere of heaven, we could say that the flow of the kingdom, we could say that the way of the kingdom is righteousness, peace, and joy. Amen? Isn't that what that is? That the kingdom is. So if we're going to participate in the kingdom of God, we're going to have to be in an atmosphere. We're going to have to be in a flow of righteousness, peace, and joy. Praise God. And it's in the Spirit. So we could say that the flow of the Spirit is righteousness, peace, and joy. Anytime we find ourselves outside of righteousness, we know we're not in the flow of the Holy Ghost. Amen? And how many of you would agree, we could all agree, right, that since the glory of God is of God, since the glory of God is of heaven, since the glory of God is of the kingdom, that if we want the glory to come, if we want the glory to flow, then we're going to have to be in a place embracing the kingdom of God, which is righteousness, peace, and joy. Hallelujah. And so we're endeavoring in these days to pursue us, each and every one of us, abiding in. You know what abiding means, right? Dwelling in. Remember the Lord said, hold it. Hold it in the place, in the realm of the Spirit. He didn't say sometimes. It's not like we're not to be the roller coaster Christian. You know, today, glory to God, it's Sunday. We're peaceful. All is well with my soul. Praise the Lord. And then Monday comes and it's like, ah! You know, and everything gets turned upside down. No, we're not on the roller coaster. We're not on the in and the out, the in and the out. We're in the abiding place of the kingdom of God. And so what happens when a word from heaven comes? I mean, this is a word from heaven. You do realize that, right? We're not looking at only the written word of God. We're looking at the rhema word of God and the spoken word of God in heaven. Because God is endeavoring us as His people in this day to get in the place where God can manifest Himself fully. I mean, the full glory of God. I want to be a place where the full glory of God can manifest. I want this church, us assemblies, to be a place where the full glory of God can manifest. And so God will speak His word from heaven. He'll say something to us and help us get on a path so that we can agree with and get in line with what God is doing. And so when God came and released this word and said, for those that are operating in and those that are holding things in the realm of the Spirit, righteousness, peace, and joy, He kind of emphasized for us peace and joy. Amen? Amen? Now, not that righteousness isn't important. Last time I talked about there's a divine order, it seems, in this. Righteousness, peace, and joy. Righteousness leads us into peace, and peace leads us into joy. Amen? And so we got to know righteousness. But I just felt like the Lord in this moment, in this season, is particularly talking to us about peace and joy. Amen? And see, I have a feeling that a lot of us, we're looking to God for something. We're needing something to happen. We're needing a healing in our body. We're needing a breakthrough. We're needing a turnaround. We're needing a something. And we're praying for the glory, praying for the answer. But we haven't yet really aligned ourselves in atmosphere of the flow of heaven. And so when the Lord released this word, you know, I like you, I'm thinking, well, Lord, you know, this is pertaining to me, and I certainly want it. I want next level glory. I believe the church, that we are headed for the best days. I still believe that even though we've seen phenomenal stuff, I mean Book of Acts stuff in this church and all around the world, I still believe that there are things that my eye has not seen yet and my ear has not heard yet that's laid up for us. And so we're going after them. And so when this word came, I began to examine with the Lord. Well, Lord, now for me personally, come on, I need to examine. Are there any places in my life that don't have peace? Okay, and I don't have time to talk about this today, but I want to say this, that peace is not just the opposite of fear. You can have no fear, but still not have peace. Okay? So we got to keep that in perspective. But I began to, you know, open up my heart and begin to search with the Lord. Is there anything in me? Is there any place in me, any area of my life, Lord, that you need to shine your light on? You know, a couple of weeks ago, I was in California ministering, and I was in worship. And we were just worshiping the Lord. And all of a sudden, as I stood there, I had my eyes closed. I saw a great light. It was like the light was on top of me. And it was a light, but as I stood there, the light got bigger and bigger and bigger and brighter until all of a sudden I was standing in like a spotlight that was coming down, praise God. And I knew it to be the light of the Lord. Amen? You know, the Bible says that God is light. There's in the kingdom of God, there's not any darkness at all. There's not even night and day. It's only light. And here I was standing in the light of the Lord. And all of a sudden, as I was standing there, I began to get warm. Now, I don't know, you know, because I was in a moment with the Spirit. I don't know if my body was really getting warm, but it felt like that. It felt like I was so warm that I warmed up on the inside all the way out to the outside. And I just heard the Lord say this to me. He said, "My light brings warmth to the soul." And then when he said that, he gave me a prophetic word. And so I got up in the meeting and released something. I don't really necessarily feel to go into that today. But what I want to tell you is that when a word comes from God, it is our responsibility to present ourselves to God and let Him shine His light in our heart. It's not the time to keep our own things pulled back and kind of reserved. You know, God, this is my life. This is something that I've kind of dealt with. This is kind of mine. It's almost like sometimes we want to hide things from the Lord. Almost like our mind convinces us that if we let God shine His light, that it's going to be unpleasant to us. But I want you to know that the light of the Lord brings warmth. Amen. The light of God brings warmth to our soul. Amen. And so as we're ministering, as we're talking about the peace of God, I want you to open up your heart and let God identify for you some places that you need to pursue getting in and holding the peace of God in that area. That's important if we're going to see the glory of God in the measure that we want it done. In Isaiah chapter 58, there's the account, it's an Old Testament passage, but it's an account of the Lord calling one to a fast. And it's called the Lord's Chosen Fast. And it's a great, it says that it's gonna break the bonds of wickedness. I mean, it's gonna help you get free. But then it goes on later to say that this is not the time to hide our flesh. That when we hide our flesh back, it's that when we pull things from God and we're thinking, this is mine and I'm kind of protecting it. I'm kind of protective of it. I'm not going to let God have full access to it. Then we don't get the full benefits. The Bible says that when we don't hide our flesh, then instead the light breaks through in the morning. Hallelujah. And we get the victory. Hallelujah. So we got to make sure that we've got our hearts open to hear what God wants to say and how God says it. Now the foundational, another foundational scripture for what God is talking about the glory of God, accompanying the peace of God and the joy of God, is from Luke chapter 2. Remember when Jesus, when the angel showed up to declare that Jesus was going to be born, the Savior of the world, it says that they appeared to the shepherds that were in the field. All right, it says the angel of the Lord appeared. Hallelujah. I would say that's the glory of God. The angelic presence, the angelic host, that's a demonstration of the glory of God. That's a manifestation. We do know that angels are real, right? So it's not just like a far-fetched. Angels are still real. They're still around today. They're still helping us, assisting us, even though we don't always see them or we don't see them with a natural eye, even though we don't even always know spiritually when they're present, they are present. Hallelujah. And so it says that the angel stood before the shepherds, and it said the glory of the Lord shone all around them. Hallelujah. And what was the declaration about Jesus coming? It was that there was going to be peace on earth. Hallelujah. The angel of God declared that there was going to be peace on earth. And that declaration by God through the angel of the peace of God, goodwill on earth toward all men. He said it was a good tiding of great joy. So he was declaring that this peace that was coming, this peace that was going to be accessible to you and I, was going to bring great joy. We see there the connection again of peace and joy. But we see here that when the peace of God was declared into the earth, when the joy and that peace was declared, when it was presented into the earth, it was presented with the glory of God. The glory of God accompanied the peace of God. And so I like to say it this way, that peace and joy set the stage for the glory of God to show up. And that is what God, listen, God does like to show up, okay? Now, God doesn't do things just to prove that He's God, but God is still in the showing up and showing out business. God wants to do things that no man can do. God wants to do things that undeniably is God and God alone, amen? And so the peace and the joy set the stage for the manifestation of God's glory. Peace and joy being present, our heart being in a place of peace, peace in the atmosphere, that sets the stage so that the glory of God can show up. Hallelujah. Praise God. You know, a couple of weeks ago, I went to meet a friend of mine for lunch. She's from out of town. And she was in town for business and asked if I could come meet her. So I drove over there and we were having lunch. And she asked me, she said, I missed your word for the year. And she said, you know, I always listen to that and appreciate it so much. So tell me a little something about what God is saying to you, you know, what y'all were pursuing, what you're pursuing with the Lord. And so I just very briefly just shared with her a few things about next level glory. I believe that there's a realm of the glory that we haven't yet tapped into. And I don't know about y'all, but I am like so very hungry. Amen. I'm talking about hungry. Get down on my feet. Get down on my knees. Put my face to the floor. Just a hunger. Just a hunger in these days for more of God. For the glory of God. And as I was sharing, she pulled out a piece of paper from her purse. And when she pulled out the piece of paper, the Lord spoke to me and He said, I want you to read that. Before she ever said a word about it, He said, I want you to read that. Well, she said to me, she said, I just printed this off of my computer and I stuck it in my purse and I haven't really read it. She said, but I skimmed through it. And so I wanted to share something of it with you today because it's in relation to what we're talking about. Amen. You know, I believe that God is wanting to pour out His Spirit upon the church. And and there's an aspect of me that believes that we don't have to wait for some big move, some big, you know, whether you want to call it revival. I'm all for revival, but I believe that we, the church, can really live in a perpetual revival. That's really what I'm after. I'm not after God just blowing in and giving a visitation. I'm all for that if He wants to do it. But I believe that every week we meet, we're supposed to be seeing the manifested glory of God. I mean, healing should be taking places. Devils should be coming out. People should be getting filled with the Spirit. And so I'm in pursuit of the outpouring of God's Spirit always in my personal life, because I believe I can live in a revival. Whether you want to live there with me or not, I can live there. I'm pursuing to live in revival. But I also believe corporately that we're to be pursuing revival and the outpouring. And so sometime back years ago, the Lord started talking to me about what He called conditions conducive to revival. And so now that I've looked, you know, God said that at that time, and He gave me 5 when He first said it. Now I have 12 of them, because He's just continually over these past few years been building things and showing me things about if we're really going to house the fullness of an outpouring of God individually and corporately, there has to be the flow of heaven, the atmosphere of God. The ways of the kingdom have to be present so that God can show up and work and move and operate. The Holy Spirit is going to move and operate in these atmospheres. Yes. Hallelujah. And so I just love how God does that. You know, He shows you things. So anyway, she pulled this out and I said, well, let me see this. And so what this is this is a word that a guy got, a man got. He was praying one day, and he said that the Lord began to talk to him about revival or outpouring or a stirring, whatever it is that you want to call it. And he told him, he said that the principles that Charles Finney taught, he said there were principles that Charles Finney taught. Do you know who Charles Finney is? He was a great revivalist way back in he lived in the 1800s? Okay, he brought millions and millions of people into the kingdom of God. And the presence of God and the power of God was so strong in his ministry that it's reported today that somewhere between 80 and 90% of his converts remained faithful. Remained faithful. Do you know that Billy Graham today, who we love and admire, and what a wonderful man, he says that 10% of his converts have remained faithful. See, there's something about a depth of the Spirit. There's something about the Holy Spirit and the depth of the Spirit getting inside a person and totally arresting them to a degree. To a degree that the way and the sway of the world doesn't hold any weight at all to the depth of what took place in him. And he began, the Lord was telling this man that in these days, as we're crying out, you know, we're crying out for the last outpouring, we're crying out for the greatest revival ever seen. He said the principles of Finney must be in place. And so I want to just read y'all a couple. There are 10 of them. And so this man went back and, of course, began to research it. Well, what's happening in Finney, with Finney's day and what he was preaching that set the way, made the stage, created a place for the glory of God to come in what we would call a revival manner or an outpouring manner. And I just want to read a couple of these because you're going to see that what's happening. Now, this is the first, I've not studied Finney really. This is the first I've seen of this or heard of this. But you know, you're going to see that what we're pursuing is right in line with what's happening here. And the Lord went actually on to tell this guy, he said, don't be surprised when you hear the prophets start preaching and teaching these things. Because we certainly ought to be hearing what God is saying and releasing it in the body of Christ. One of the principles is prayer. Amen. Now, how many of y'all know that we've really been vamping it up, kicking it up in prayer? I mean, how often am I standing up here telling you that a praying church is a powerful church, that everybody ought to be finding some way to get in corporate prayer? I mean, we've got 2 Tuesday nights. We've got every Monday through Thursday in the mornings. We've got weekly Tuesday afternoons. We've got a Saturday morning prayer. Everybody ought to be getting in prayer. Listen, if you want to live in revival, if you want to live in the fullness of the Spirit, you're going to have to pray. Pray, pray, pray. Prayer prepares the way for the glory of God. I love that. Then another one here, another principle is the principle of holiness. I would call this the fear of the Lord. Y'all remember a couple years ago we were on the fear of the Lord, how God was talking to us about coming out of the casualness of our ways and coming into the real reverent awe of who God is. I mean, respect and honor in the presence of God. Another principle is the principle of power. I'd say we preach that all the time. The principle of faith. We are the faith church, right? But look at this. Number six, principles of joy in the Holy Spirit. Principle number seven, principles of righteousness. I just love this. This is how God does this. Number nine, principles of peace. I've never ever heard before the Lord talked to me this year. It was not on my conditions. I added it. It was the 12th thing that I've added to my list of things that make way, that make room, that present a space, a place, an atmosphere for God to show up, for the glory of God to manifest. But before that, I'd never heard this. And here was God saying, I'm just confirming. He was just confirming to me what He's talking to us about these days. And this is why we've got to get ourselves personally in a place where we know the peace of God. Okay? Now I'm trying to prove to you that peace is a powerful something. Let me give you a couple definitions of peace. It comes from the root word shalom. It means to be complete, whole, lacking nothing. Okay? And this is not just about our life as our life, but it's all of the surroundings of our life. It means nothing lacking in the surroundings of our life. Amen? It means to be in harmony. It means to be in right relationship. One aspect of the peace of God I'm not going to preach on today, but I'm going to do next time, is about living harmoniously with God and with other people. Listen, if you can't get your heart in peace and live in total perfect peace with everybody around you, I said everybody around you, your bosses around you, your spouses around you, your siblings, then you're gonna pull yourself outside of the atmosphere of peace which God needs in order to come in and manifest. Yes. The third definition is freedom from disturbance. I like that one. Freedom from disturbance, of any kind of disturbance. Disturbance in your physical body, disturbance in your mind, disturbance in situations. There's a way to be in peace where you are totally free of disturbance, of turmoil, of conflict, of uneasiness. And instead, you have entered into tranquility, restfulness, a calmness, a stillness. Hallelujah. That's the peace of God. Hallelujah. Now, we see that when the angels came on the scene, God was declaring peace. So it's God that declared peace, and He sent Jesus to provide peace. Romans 5:1 says that we have peace with God through Jesus Christ. So let me first say that you're never going to have peace without having a vibrant relationship with Jesus Christ. Peace is of God. And you will never get it outside of a relationship with God. So if there's anybody in the room today that has not yet made Jesus the Lord of your life, you're going to listen as we go on to these wonderful attributes of peace. And you're going to think, yeah, I gotta have that. In a very unstable and shaky and dark and crazy world today, the peace of God anchors us and gives us stability. And we're only going to get that through Jesus Christ. So first, we know that the relationship comes by us believing in Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. So turn with me in your Bibles to Romans chapter 15, verse 13. I want you to look at this. I love this scripture. It's a great scripture. Of course, all the scripture is good. Praise God. Romans chapter 15, verse 13. It says, now may the God of hope, so we're talking about God here, fill you. Fill who? Fill who? Fill you. May He fill you with joy and peace. Look at that. They're connected again. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in what? In believing. Do you see that? In believing. Okay? So peace comes from believing. Your peace is only going to be found in believing, in trusting. First, Jesus as the Lord of your life. And let me just say this. If you have, quote, received Jesus, but you are straddling the fence and you are trying to call Jesus Lord and have a lot of other stuff, you're going to be completely miserable. And you're going to live outside the flow of the kingdom of heaven. Even though you have a seal of the Spirit, you're going to live outside of the true flow of the kingdom of heaven if you don't fully get in, fully believe, fully trust, and surrender all of your life to Jesus. Listen, Jesus wants to be Lord of all. He wants to be Lord of all. Amen. So he's either Lord of all or he's Lord of nothing. Okay, so we're going to find peace. We're going to be filled with joy and peace in believing in Jesus as our Savior. But also what happens, Jesus is what? He is the Word. Yes. Jesus is the Word. Isn't that what it said? John 1:1 in the beginning was the Word. And the Word was Jesus. Yes. So Jesus is the Word. So we're going to be filled with joy and peace in believing the Word. Amen. The Word, the written Word. The scriptures that God has written, that God threw in through way a whole bunch of trouble to pen some things so that we could live our life by. And also the spoken word, what God has said. When God speaks to you, you must believe. Yes. You're going to have to contradict your mind trying to get a hold of it. And how can this be and what can it mean? And what? No. You got to believe. If you want peace, you're going to have to believe. The God of hope is going to fill you with all joy and peace in believing. I love that. It's so simple. It's just believe. Yes. If we just believe, then God is required to do all the hard stuff. We just simply believe. Praise God. So there's peace in believing. So we're going to have to learn to believe. We're going to have to learn to live in faith. Not have a little faith sometimes. Live in faith. Operate in faith. Have faith, stay in faith, so that we can have peace. Faith and peace, they're connected, man. You're not going to have peace without the faith. Okay? So we're going to have to believe. We're going to have to believe the Word of God. Turn with me to Psalm 119, verse 165. Let's just look at a couple of scriptures here on this real quick. Psalm 119, verse 165 says this, great peace. Woo! I want it. Great peace have those who love your law. Great peace, not a little peace. Great peace have those who love your law. Now, in the Old Testament, the law would now translate today to a New Testament believer, to the Word. So great peace have those who love His Word. Amen. Great peace have those who love His Word. And nothing causes them to stumble. Nothing. Listen, if we will love the Word of God, if we will believe the Word of God, hallelujah, then nothing gets to cause us to stumble, to fall, to get tripped up, or to get offended. Praise God. Isaiah 26, you don't have to turn there. I'm going to read this one. I'm talking about believing because the Bible says in Romans 15 that we're filled with all peace in believing. Isaiah 26, verse 3 says, God, you will keep him, us, in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed upon you because he trusts in you. Amen. So we're going to have to get the Word of God and we're going to have to get our mind stayed upon it. We're going to have to get our eyes on that Word. We're going to have to keep our mouth on that Word. We're going to have to keep that Word coming in our ear. If we will keep the Word of God before us, if we will keep our mind stayed upon that, then he will keep us in perfect peace. Look, it says, you will keep us. Not yourself is going to keep you. He will keep us. Yes. Don't take the work of God and try to make the work of God work for you. It's God's responsibility. It's God's promise to keep you in perfect peace. Your job is to keep your mind stayed upon Him. And if you'll keep your mind stayed upon Him, what will happen is you'll find yourself trusting in Him. You'll find yourself believing in Him. Believing more than a contrary report or an out there situation. We're going to keep our mind stayed upon Him and stay in perfect peace. Because when we do, then it sets the stage for God to get involved. And to God to change things around. And God to make things happen. To bring His glory on the scene. And us get the desired result. Don't turn there, but again, I want to read this. 1 Peter 5, 7 says, casting all your care upon Him, for He cares for you. Amen. Casting all your care. And you know, a lot of times we read that scripture, we think of care in the negative direction. Casting all of your care, all of your burdens, all of your concerns, all of your worries to God. And I say that's good. We should do that. We should cast everything over to God. But the Lord showed me one time that word care doesn't mean just that. It says we're to cast our care upon Him because He cares for us. Do you think He worries and frets and has burdens about us? No. So that ought to tell us a little something. Maybe that word's bigger than what we know. And so when the Lord spoke that word to me, I said, oh yeah, cast our burdens and our worries. He said, no, that's the negative side of care. But what care really means, it's our focus and our attention. So we're to cast our focus and our attention upon Him because He has His focus and His attention on us. Hey, 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 and if God's got His focus on me, if God's got His focus on you, hey, if God be for us, who can be against us? Hey, what can mere man do to me? So if we're going to stay in peace, we're going to have to cast our care, which includes all the negative stuff, but we're going to have to cast all of our effort, our focus, our energy, our attention upon God. Upon God. That's in a sense, that's saying the same thing. Keeping our mind, keeping our heart, keeping our eyes, our ears, our mouth upon Him. Amen. This is good stuff, isn't it? Yes. Praise God. So God is giving us, He's telling us that if we want this peace, see what I feel is that we're praying for something, but we haven't positioned ourselves that God can really work. Listen, you're never going to be able to make it happen, do it all yourself. You don't have the ability. You don't have the power. It's only the power of God that can make things change. It's God's responsibility to do that. But what we do is we partner with Him and we position ourselves with Him. And that is in the atmosphere or in the flow or in the ways of the kingdom of God. So before you start praying for your body to be healed, you ought to make sure that you've got peace in your heart. Because I'm going to tell you that it's going to be very difficult to get spiritual things to happen, spiritual things to manifest, if you're not operating in the parameters of the kingdom of heaven. Okay, so back to Romans 15. Are you still there? Romans 15, 13. So it's the God of hope that's going to fill us. I love that word, fill. Everybody say fill. Yeah. Not just a trickle. Not just a little. He's going to fill us with all joy and peace in believing. And look what it says here. That you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. The power of the Holy Spirit. So it's God that declares it, Jesus that provides it, but it's the Holy Spirit in us that works it. The Holy Spirit works the peace of God. So this is a peace of God that's within. It's not an emotion. Emotions are of our soul, right? Man made of three parts, spirit, soul, and body. Our spirit is where the Holy Spirit lives. Our spirit is perfect. Our spirit is supposed to rule our soul. Our soul is made up of our mind, our will, and our emotions. Okay? So I'm not talking about an emotion of peace. I'm talking about an inward work of peace. Hallelujah. We are to be filled by His Spirit with the anointing of peace. The anointing is something, it was what was put upon Jesus. It was a grace that was put upon. An anointing is a grace, an enablement, as something that is put upon someone. Jesus was had the Spirit of God put upon Him. He was called what? The Prince of Peace. He had the anointing of peace upon Him. Hallelujah. We're to be filled with the anointing of peace by the Holy Spirit. So peace in our spirit by the Holy Spirit. Amen? And it's as we're continually in fellowship, in relationship with the Word of God. Hallelujah. And the Spirit of God, you know, it's the Spirit that makes the Word come alive in us. It's the Spirit that does the work of the Word in us. Amen. It's as we're continually in relationship that we're being filled with the Holy Spirit that the peace is being worked in us. Hallelujah. You see, peace, it's a fruit of our spirit. Galatians 5:22. The fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, and self-control. It's a fruit of our spirit. A fruit is something that's produced. Peace should be what's produced in our life from what is within us. Hallelujah. We are connected to Jesus, the vine. The Bible, John 15, says Jesus is the vine. Hallelujah. And we are what? We are the branches. We are connected to Him. Well, you know what happens? A branch flows with whatever they're connected to. So whatever you're connected to is what's going to flow to you and what's going to flow through you. Amen? Hallelujah. And so we're connected to Jesus, the Prince of Peace, who has the anointing of peace. And so the peace of God is put in our heart by the Holy Spirit, but we have to develop that peace. Okay? Because we have a soul. We have a soul that tries to house the Spirit of God. And the Bible says that the mind and the soul is at enmity. It's the struggle of your spirit man and your soul. Your desire is to get your spirit man so big, so strong, and so dominant that it produces what comes out of your spirit and dominates your soul. So really what's important is the working measure of peace within you. Because truth is, once we're born again, we're instantly born of the peace of God. And that's why most of us, when we gave our life to Jesus, we instantly felt a peace. First of all, we were reconciled to God. There was a peace that came in our heart. But we have to be living in a body in a working measure so that that peace of God that's in our spirit actually produces a fruit of peace in our life. So that when we get in situations and when we get in things, we're not moved and we're not all over the place. We're like, oh yeah, I got the peace of God. Oh yeah, I know what God has said about this. Oh yeah, I'm keeping my eyes upon Jesus. Hallelujah. So it's only as we develop peace within our heart. It's only as we walk in peace. It's only as we let peace have its way and have its rule in our life. You know, you have to yield to peace. There's going to be times when the moment comes, maybe it's an argument, there's going to be a moment where you get to choose to let peace rise up and not pull you into turmoil and conflict, or you get to side with your soul, your flesh, and go there. But what did God say? He said, we got to operate in, we got to hold things in peace. And that's why I'm like, Lord, show me whatever area might be in any way, shape, or form, holding me back from this next level glory in the fullness of what you want to do in this hour. Because I don't want to step outside of peace. And God did show me something, and I'm working on it. Praise God, I'm working on it. Because I'm going to grab it. I've got to grab it. The glory of God, the kingdom, is too important to me to let anything of my flesh hold me back.
Amen.
So it's as we let peace. Come on, everybody say let. As we let peace rule in our heart. As we let peace have its way, that we reap the benefits. Listen, it's so much better to live in peace. It's so much better to live in peace. And this is God's intent all along, is that all of us would live in peace. Amen. It says in Acts chapter 9, verse 31, it said that the churches, listen to this, the churches throughout all Judea, Galilee, and Samaria had peace. The churches all had peace. That ought to set our standard and our bar real high. That all of the churches had peace, and it says, and were edified and were built up. Come on, there is a building up of us when we get in the peace of God. Yes. Because number one, we're operating in the kingdom of heaven.
Yes. That's right.
So it says they were all had peace and were edified, and they were walking in the fear of the Lord and in the comfort of the Holy Spirit. If you want the Spirit to operate in your life, you're going to have to work at letting peace dominate. And I love this because this shows me it's not just individual, but it's corporate. Yeah. I believe that there's a corporate way to have the peace of God. I believe that in this place, can abide the anointing of peace on this house. As a matter of fact, the Lord said that to me one time. He said that this house would be known as a house of peace, and the anointing of my peace will rest upon it. I would go so far as to say there have been many of you that have walked in here at times, and when you got in here, it's like, oh yeah, you just got settled in the peace of God. Yeah, it happens. Hallelujah. Jesus was the Prince of Peace. He ministered peace. He commanded peace. He presented peace. He maintained peace. He preserved peace. And he often spoke peace to people. Amen. He would say, I'm not going to go through all the scriptures today, but you ought to look them up. He would say to them, peace to you. Yes. Now listen, Jesus was very intentional with his word. He wasn't just like, peace to you. That meant something. There was a force of heaven when those words came. Peace to you. Peace be upon you. He spoke peace into places and into situations. What I want you to know that the peace of God is real. The peace of God is a living force. It's a living force. It comes from heaven. It comes from the Holy Spirit. Is it alive? It is present. You can see it. You can feel it. You can touch it. You can live in it. You can operate in it. Hallelujah. It's tangible. You know, years ago when I was a single woman, in my house, I had what I called my God space. Okay, and it was my God. I had a big chair there, and I had kind of an open space there. And so it was there that when I would come home from work, that was my meeting place with God. It was where my prayer was with God. It was where my praise was with God. I mean, I would dance around that room. I would sit in that chair for hours and hours and pour out my heart and listen and just get close and connected. It was my God space. Well, one time I had something, I don't remember what it was, but I had something wrong in my house. And so I had a friend from work who was going to come to my house and check it out and try to fix it for me. And so this was a guy who was saved. I had been working with several people at my place of employment, trying to get them, first get them saved, then get them into the Spirit-filled life. And then I did manage to do both of that with them, but I never could get them into church. That was my third goal. But anyway, so I was working. So he had some knowledge of God. You know, he certainly wasn't what we would know. But anyway, he walks in the house, and wherever we was going, we had to walk by my God space. And of course, you know, when people walk in, I'm not like, well, this is my God. You know, no. We just went in the house, and so I'm in front of him, and I'm walking, and he gets to a place, and I hear him go, whoa. Wow. And I turn around, he goes, what is that? And I said, what is what? He said, right here. And he was right in the area of my God space. He was like, it's like a peace of God. He said, I can feel it. It's like a peace. What is it? I mean, he was floored. I was floored. Praise God. But my God space had a residue. Come on, come on. The Holy Spirit is real like that, folks. There was a residue of peace. And he could feel it inside. And so I just explained to him. I took the opportunity. Praise God. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Let me share here about a real living, tangible presence and force of God through the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. Praise God. So the peace of God can come into a place. Yes. Now, you do remember we're the church. So it's not like God just floats in a place. We are connected with that space. But I'm going to prove to you that God can have his anointing of peace come in a place and remain there. It can affect an atmosphere. Let me say it that way. It can affect an atmosphere. And that situation, it affected the atmosphere in my house. The peace of God can be so tangible that it can come upon you. I mean, really come upon you. I know we've done this in the women's meeting sometimes. We'll just get in there and all of a sudden we'll just start praying and get real quiet. And I mean, it's like the peace of God comes in like a flood. I mean, it just comes in. And almost everybody in the room can tell what's going on. When I was in Arequipa, Peru one time, I was preaching in the morning, and I woke up that morning and I thought I knew what I was going to preach. But I woke up literally in my bed. I woke up with a tangible anointing of peace on me. It was so heavy that I laid in my bed for 20 minutes I just didn't even want to move. I was just thinking, wow, I mean, it was just so real. It was just so present. Well, duh, when I finally realized I got to get up, duh, I figured I better do something. I had an anointing of peace. I had a tangible force of heaven. And so you know what I did, right? I went to the meeting and did what? I ministered on peace. I ministered on peace, and I laid hands on the ladies and the people that were there for the peace of God to flow in their life. And by the way, in that same meeting as I was ministering, I did a two-part thing. I did something on the peace of God because I felt like the goal was to get my hands on people and release what was on me to them. You know, that is a doctrine of Christ, the laying on of hands.
Yes.
Something of the Spirit flows from you into someone else. Uh-huh. And so after that, I began to minister on our authority. Woo! You ought to try ministering on talking about authority when you're in a place of peace. And you know what happened? An earthquake hit. And you know what happened when the earthquake hit? I mean, I didn't have to for any. It was so brief. Because instantly I was in a place of peace that there was nothing. It was like walking through a storm that Peter walked through. You remember that storm? And it was so quick. And what I just shouted was I just took authority over it, and it instantly stopped.
Amen.
It instantly stopped. No more trembles, no more shaking. I mean, it was so, and listen, this was, it registered on the Richter scale. It was reported miles down the thing, they had buildings collapse and all kind of things go on. But not where we were at, because we were in the peace of God. Turn with me to Luke chapter 10, verse 5. Jesus said this to his disciples. He said, but whatever house you enter, first say, peace to this house. Listen, Jesus is training the disciples, and he said, say to the house, say to those present in the house, however you want to look at it. But he said this, he said, say first, because peace is going to prepare the way. Say first. Get in peace first. He said, say first to the house, peace to this house. And if a son of peace is there, look at that. Your peace will rest on it. Your peace will rest on it. So go ahead, present peace. And if they'll receive peace and embrace peace, then peace will rest on it. The peace of God is real. It's a real living force of heaven. And it does something. It accomplishes something. It's not just a, hey, peace. And it's not just so you can sit back in your chair and feel good, although that is a really good feeling. But it's bigger than that. It's making a way. It's setting a stage for the glory of God. Hallelujah. Turn with me to Mark chapter 4. So peace can change things. I mean, peace can have a real effect. On people, on places, on situations. I'm going to prove it. Mark chapter 4, verses 35 through 41. This is the account where Jesus got with the disciples and he said, let us cross over to the other side. And they got in the boat. They got in the boat. What happened? The big storm came up. The winds began to blow. The seas began, the waves began to be big coming over into the boat. The disciples, they got scared. They thought they were going to die. And so they rushed to get Jesus. They rush to get him up, and he stands up, and what does he do? What does he say? What does he say? Does he start speaking to the winds and the... No, he just releases a word. He says, peace, be still. Isn't that interesting? Have you ever wondered about that? Why he didn't speak directly to the wind, or why he didn't speak directly in that way? He addressed it as simply peace. What he did was he released through his word, because he was the Prince of Peace and he had peace in him. Listen, you're never going to be able to produce something that's not in you. If you want to speak peace and produce peace, you're going to have peace in you. But when Jesus spoke peace, peace, the tangible force, the atmosphere of the kingdom of heaven came and stilled, and the glory of God came. The glory of God came. How do I know the glory of God came? Because everything stopped. Everything got still. Everything came into order. Everything shifted. Everything redirected. Many times what needs to happen is we need to speak peace. First of all, you need to speak it to yourself. There's been times when my stomach has been bothering me, like my stomach, you know, feel like, and I will just get in there and I'm speaking peace to my stomach. Peace in the name of, I'm just speaking peace. Because the command of peace, the force of peace, the anointing of peace will cause things to change. It will cause things to rearrange. It will cause things to line up. It will cause things to come in order. So sometimes you need to speak peace to yourself. And sometimes you need to speak peace into your situation. But listen, don't try speaking peace into your situation if you are not yet in peace. If you got something going on with your body and you're concerned about it and you're not anchored on the fact of whatever word it is that you know from heaven, if you don't have a total peace in your heart, there's no way that when you speak peace, it's going to produce anything. It's got to come from a place of faith. It's got to come from a place of believing. So you got to get in peace and then you got to speak peace. You got to find where you're at in this thing. You got to find, listen, this is why sometimes we're not seeing the miracles that we want. We're not seeing the things that we yet want. We're not yet in the place of the flow of the kingdom, of the flow of the Spirit. We haven't yet established peace in ourselves. But when we do, we can stand up and we can speak peace. We can bring peace. We can make peace be still. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's what happened. You see it here. The glory of God connected with the peace of God. The manifestation of a whole stopping of a storm. You know, a storm represents the troubles in your life. This is not just a physical storm, although it works that way also. But these are talking about storms in your life. You have the ability to release peace into those situations and make them line up. Make them get in order. I like that. Get in order. Man, sometimes I'm just like, this has got to get in order. I mean, now it's got to get in order. That's what turmoil. Remember, peace is the freedom from turmoil, from conflict, from things being out of order, disturbing, chaotic. Now, sometimes God's going to still the storm. Sometimes we can speak peace into a situation and command that to actually stop. I mean, the storm, the outward things actually stop. But sometimes what you're going to find is that you don't have the authority to bring peace into the outward situation. But what you do have is the ability to have a peace in your heart that carries you through the storm. And you're going to have to get sharp enough and sensitive enough in the spirit to know where your authority is. But in every situation, whether you have the authority to still the outward thing of the storm, or whether you're going to just walk through it, I want you to know that God has provided a place of peace. And He expects you to have peace in your heart. And it's only as you have peace, only as you operate in peace, only as you hold it in peace, that you will walk through that storm. And that's what we see with Peter in Matthew chapter 14. Y'all remember that? That account where Peter was in the boat, the disciples were in the boat, the storm, and Jesus was walking on the water. Y'all remember that? Remember, there was a storm. And what did Peter say? Peter said, Lord, if it's you, beckon to me to come to you. And so first what we see is that Jesus said, come. Okay, so Peter had a word. He had a word from God. If you're walking through a storm, you're going to have the word. You're going to have a promise. You're going to have something that God has spoken to you.
Amen.
But in the midst of that storm, Peter stood up in that boat with that word from heaven, and he did what? He looked at Jesus. He had his eyes stayed upon Jesus. He had his mind stayed upon Jesus, and he began to walk. I always found it so interesting. Why didn't Jesus just still the storm? Come on, we already saw that Jesus had stilled the storm in Mark chapter 4. We knew he could have done it. We knew we could have told Peter to do it. Come on, folks. These are principles for us to live by. What it means is that sometimes chaotic storm type stuff is going to be going on around you, but God wants you to know that there is a word from heaven, that there is a promise to you, that if you'll get yourself in peace and you'll anchor yourself and just begin to keep your eyes on Jesus, you'll walk right through that storm. Now today we're going to forget the second part of the story where Peter did what? Peter did what? He had peace and he was doing it, man. And all of a sudden, it says he began to look around. He began to look around. Remember, great peace are those who love your law. He's going to keep us in perfect peace when we're stayed upon him. So you're going to have to keep your eyes on Jesus. But what I'm trying to tell you is that the force of peace is real. I mean, in that moment, when the word came, he got peace in his heart. He got out of the boat. The glory of God manifested. Come on, the glory accompanied the peace. He walked on water. I would say that's the glory of God. Walking on water. I believe that if Peter had stayed his eyes on Jesus and never veered, he would have walked completely through the storm. So the glory of God for you is going to come if you'll be in peace. Hallelujah. Peace, it's setting a stage. It's setting a stage. So Jesus, he carried the anointing of peace. He brought it. He ministered it. And so we as sons of God, we do the same.
Yes.
We do the same. We do the same. Turn with me to John 20, 21. John chapter 20, verse 21. I'm going to try to get through these very quickly. John chapter 20, verse 21. Jesus said this when he was commissioning his disciples. In other words, this was after Jesus had died, gone to the cross. This is when he was giving the commission to them. He said this. Verse 21, so Jesus said to them again, peace to you. He prefaced their commission by saying peace. In other words, if you're going to do your assignment, if you're going to go forth and you're going to operate as you're to operate, peace, peace must be with you. Peace to you. Peace must be upon you. He said, peace to you. As the Father has sent me, I also send you. So we see that whatever Jesus did is what we're supposed to be doing. Praise God, without the exception of hanging on the cross, thank you, Jesus. Whatever Jesus did, whatever work he did, that's the work that we do. That's what we're assigned to do. We're commissioned to do, but we must have peace with us. Matthew chapter 5, don't turn there. Verse 9 says this, blessed are the peacemakers, for they are the sons of God. Blessed, blessed, fortunate, happy are the peacemakers. I love that. Not just those that have peace, but the peacemaker. I'm a peacemaker. Yeah. Come on, you're a peacemaker. Yeah. Come on, when we walk into a situation, oh yeah, I got the peace of God with me. I got the peace of God on me. Something subject to change here, because we are peacemakers. We are peace bringers. We are ones that bring peace, a tangible force of the kingdom of heaven into a situation and make things change.
Yes. Yes.
And the glory will show up.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jesus told his early disciples to operate in the anointing of peace, to bring it, to leave it, to command it, to operate in it. And so we're to do the same. Turn with me back to Luke chapter 10. You might still be there. No, I think you're in John. Luke chapter 10. This is going to be the last. Let me see if I say it before I say that, if it's the truth. It is the truth. This is the last scripture. Hallelujah. Luke chapter 10. I want y'all to look at this really good. I love this. This is Jesus' instructions to the disciples. He said, but whatever house you enter, remember we saw this, first say, peace to this house. So again, he's talking about setting an atmosphere. He's talking about setting a flow. He's talking about making a place for something to happen. Watch what happens here. He said, if a son of peace, verse 6, is there, your peace will rest on it. Matthew 10:13 says, let your peace come upon it. And if not, it will return to you. Isn't that interesting? Peace so tangible, so present, that it has the ability to come and stay or to come right back to you. Then skip down to verse 9, see what it says. And heal the sick there. And say to them that the kingdom of God has come near you. What's he saying? He's saying, if you go and you present the atmosphere of peace and the peace of God is there, then you can heal the sick. The atmosphere of peace sets the stage for the glory of God. The anointing of healing came as a result of the atmosphere of peace being in a home. And he was very specific. If they receive it, let it rest and then heal the sick. He didn't say just go in and say, hey, you know, you want me to pray for you? You want me to pray for you? No. He said, see if the atmosphere of heaven, see if you can get the flow of the kingdom in that present place. Because the glory accompanies peace. And I just see this a lot. I see this a lot in the healing ministry. I can always tell when we're in an atmosphere where it's like heaven is here. The kingdom. And that's what he said. And then tell them that the kingdom is here. Tell them that the kingdom is near. Tell them that the kingdom has come. Hallelujah. Now the cool thing is that we have the right and the ability to live in the kingdom all the time. That's why God's talking about operating and living in, holding things in the realm of the Spirit, not going in and out, in and out. We're called to get in and stay in. But listen, there's going to be some people that you're going to come up against or up to that aren't going to be, they're not going to be in a place or in a space. I've ministered before where the power of God present come right out of me. I can feel it go out of me and come right back to me because the person that I've released it to didn't get it, didn't receive it. Wasn't open. It's not what I like. We don't like those kind of stories, but it is what it is. The Bible said here, if they don't want it, it's going to come back to you. Amen. And this ought to help us because, you know, we can get a little disappointed when we're not seeing results like we think we ought to see them. And we should be getting results. That's why we have to understand the kingdom of heaven and how the kingdom of God operates and what it's required of us, the conditions that we need to be familiar with so that we can make room for the glory of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. It's the peace of God. It's part of the kingdom atmosphere. It's the flow of the kingdom. It makes way for the things of God, the manifestations of God, the demonstrations of God, the healings, the deliverances. The peace sets the stage. It makes the way. Hallelujah. It's difficult. It's difficult. It's difficult for the kingdom to show up when the flow of the kingdom is not present. And I believe that we can have corporate. I really believe in the corporate anointing. Otherwise, you know, why would we have church? I mean, we could sit at home and watch. There's a corporate thing that happens when we get in the assembly together. I like that it said all of the churches had peace. That means everybody in all of those three different cities were named. Three different cities. That meant that every person in those churches had peace. That means that we can have a peace. We can have an anointing of peace. We can have a flow of peace where not one single person gets left out. But we got to let peace. We got to let peace. Remember, this word that came from heaven, it was a condition with God. If you, that's a condition. If you, that's how the whole word started. If you will operate in and hold things in the realm of the Spirit, then my glory, God, then my glory will come. God's wanting to work with us. He's not just God in heaven poofing. That we wish it was like that. I wish it was like that. But it's about working with us. And one of the parameters of our heart is having the working measure of peace that makes way and makes room for the glory of God.
Thank you for joining us for the preaching of God's Word. We trust that your faith and your love for God is stronger than ever before. Chaz and Joni Stevenson have a New Testament vision of spreading the full gospel of Christ around the world, helping unbelievers meet Jesus Christ, and building strong Christians who can impact their world and are doing so by preaching the uncompromised Word of God with the power of the Holy Spirit. To join us in that vision, please consider an offering to help with media costs or an offering to simply show the value of the spiritual things you have received. You may give online, by mail, or by phoning in with a credit card. If you're in Houston, Texas, and looking for a good home church, Pastors Chaz and Joni invite you to a Spirit-filled, life-changing service at Houston Faith Church, where we're certain you'll experience the love and goodness of God in a real and powerful way. For more information about God, Houston Faith Church, or Stevenson Ministries, please visit us on the web where you can now watch services via live streaming and find many other life-changing resources, or download our Houston Faith phone app.